Today we are taking up Rhinoceros by Eugene Ionesco. Now before we begin with the play, let's look at his life. He was born on 26 November 1909 in Romania and he died on March 28, 1994 in Paris, France. He was a Romanian-born French dramatist whose one-act anti-play, The Bald Soprano, inspired a revolution in dramatic techniques and helped inaugurate the theater of the absurd. Elected to the Academy Francaise in 1970, Ionesco remains among the most important dramatists of the 20th century. 1975 dramatization of Eugene Ionesco's one-act play The New Tenant is an excellent example of theater of the absurd, though the author himself preferred to describe his work as theater of derision. If we look at his works, there are many. You have The Lesson, The Chairs, The Killer, Rhinoceros, Exit the King, A Stroll in the Air, Thirst and Hunger. Then in the next decade, he wrote Killing Game, Macbeth, B-E-T-T, M-A-C-B-E-T-T, was a retelling of Shakespeare's Macbeth. Then A Hell of a Mess, The New Tenant, were all of his successful plays. Then most famous works are The Lesson, The Chairs and Rhinoceros. His plays or anti-plays, as he called them, break theatrical traditions of plot and sequence, and that is why they get the name of anti-plays. They are particularly modern in the degree to which they do so. The plays explore mortality and existential conundrums with fanciful and often fantastical humor. The line between fiction and reality consistently blurs as Ionesco depicts meaningless worlds that are ruled by chance. Now we'll take up the themes that he has dealt in his work Rhinoceros. So the first theme he has dealt with is will and responsibility. Now the transformation of Berenger, who is the hero, from an apathetic, alcoholic and ennui-ridden man into the savior of humanity constitutes the major theme of Rhinoceros and the major existential struggle. One must commit oneself to a significant cause in order to give life meaning. Jean continually exhorts Berenger to exercise more willpower and not surrender to life's pressures, and other characters such as Dudard seem to do just that as they control their own destinies. Berenger does not have great conventional willpower as demonstrated by his frequent recourse to alcohol and his tendency to dream both daydreams and nightmares. However, he maintains a steadfast, latent sense of responsibility after Act 1, often feeling guilty for the various rhinoceros metamorphoses around him. In a sense, his initial apathy was the cause, helping promote a climate of indifference and irresponsibility. Furthermore, he shows that he cares about Daisy, the only evidence in the play, other than Mrs. Beoff's devotion to Mr. Beoff, of sincere love for another human. By Act 3, his powerful guilt and sense of responsibility indicates that Berenger practices the most selfless kind of love, which is unconditional love for all humanity, whereby he is concerned for the welfare even of those who have scorned him. This all-encompassing love is what gives his life meaning. The supposedly strong characters like Jean fail the ultimate test of willpower, the rhino epidemic, if we may call it, because everybody is transforming into a rhino, and their crumbling wills are foreshadowed by their evasions of responsibility. Daisy, for instance, wants to live a guiltless life. Their idea of will borrows from Nietzsche's concept of the will to power. For them, will is a means to metamorphose into Nietzsche's Superman, a powerful being beyond human morality. The savagery of the rhinos and Jean's transformation and statements in Act 2 exemplify this desire for power. He becomes violent, claims humanism is dead, and tries to trample Berenger. The play's final irony is that Berenger becomes the true Superman, gathering his resources of will built on a foundation of love for his fellow man to take responsibility for humanity. Now the next theme we see is logic and absurdity. Rhinoceros exposes the limitations of logic and absurdity reigns as the dominating force of the universe. Self-proclaimed rational characters such as the logician, Botard, and Jean either flounder in their proofs, the logician especially, or ridiculously rationalize their incorrect presumptions. Consider Botard's accusation of a conspiracy in Act 2. The logician's attempts to uncover how many rhinoceros there were in the first act and what breeds they were results only in reposing the original question. In Act 1, Berenger calls Jean's ideas nonsense, and this word resonates throughout Rhinoceros. The world is nonsensical, absurd, and defies the extent of logic. As Berenger says, if one were to read about the rhinoceros events in a newspaper, away from the action, one could be rational and detached. But in the midst of things, one can't help getting involved. The balance between detached distance and intimate confusion divides the supposedly logical characters from Berenger. They maintain their logical distance until confronted with a real problem, when their logic implodes. Berenger concedes absurdity from the outset. He says life is a dream, alluding to the inexplicable randomness around him, and this enables him to understand the absurdity of the metamorphosis better, even though he never arrives at a logical solution. Recognizing the world as absurd, Ionesco suggests, is the first step in cobbling together a meaningful life. Now see, the next theme you find in this play is fascism, which is talked about in the whole of the play. The epidemic of the rhinoceros serves as a convenient allegory for the mass uprising of Nazism and fascism before and during World War II. Ionesco's main reason for writing Rhinoceros is not simply to criticize the horrors of the Nazis, but to explore the mentality of those who so easily succumbed to Nazism, a universal consciousness that subverts individual free thought and will defines this mentality. In other words, people get rolled up in the snowball of general opinion around them and they start thinking what others are thinking. In the play, people repeat ideas others have said earlier or simultaneously say the same things. Once other people, especially authority figures, collapse in the play, the remaining humans find it even easier to justify why the metamorphoses are desirable. Ionesco is careful not to make his play a one-sided critique of brutality of Nazism. The rhinos become more beautiful as the play progresses, until they overshadow the ugliness of humanity, and the audience is forced to recognize that an impressionable individual might have similarly perceived the swelling ranks of Nazis as superior. In fact, Dadaert's desire to join the universal family of the rhinos points to the notion of the rhinos as an Aryan master race, physically superior to the rest of humanity. Nevertheless, they are still morally repugnant, escalating their violence over the course of the play. Ionesco carefully traces an argument against John Stuart Mill's harm principle, which states that individual freedom should be preserved so long as it does not harm anyone else. Ionesco demonstrates that passively allowing the rhinos to go on, or allegorically turn a blind eye to fascism, as individual citizens and entire countries did in the 1930s, is as harmful as direct violence. Now see, I'd just like to tell you here about the difference we have between communism and fascism. Now communism is what we find in Hitler, and fascism was what we found in Mussolini. Now see, both of them, you'll find that similarity, you know, both of them believe in dictatorship, both of them believe in one party rule, both of them deny individual rights. In both, you have no democracy. Now see, comes the difference. Communism talks of a classless society, but fascism talks about a class-structured society, meaning you've got ranks in the society. But communism says no classes should be there in society. Then, communism, those who believe it, are internationalists, meaning they want to spread communism throughout the world. But fascism, those who follow this ideal, they call themselves nationalists, meaning they show that whatever they are doing it for the good of the country. And these are the two ideals you need to understand in order to understand the theme of fascism propagated in this particular play of Rhinoceros. Now, this play belongs to the theater of the absurd in the tradition of Samuel Beckett's Waiting for Godot, Jean-Paul Sartre's No Exit, and Harold Pinter's play Ionesco's drama combines abstract philosophical ideas with concrete humor. The various rationalizations that characters come up with to explain their previous errors delight us with their silliness, but they also suggest deeper ideas about logic and responsibility. As many of the plays from the theater of the absurd go, Rhinoceros is conscious of itself as a play, as when Jean suggests to Berenger, sees one of Ionesco's play, but more so in the ways that it forces the audience to recognize the production before them as a play and not as a diversion. A production with backlit rhinoceros heads stake no claim to the typical drama's attempts to suspend the audience's disbelief, but this is the point. Ionesco breaks the fourth wall of the theater and numerous other walls and structures explored in the play to make the audience leave the theater feeling that the absurdity they witnessed was somehow more real than a realistic play. Now we see bourgeois life being explained here. In this play, Ionesco makes a number of critiques of the emptiness of bourgeois working world. The root of Berenger's apathy seems to spring from his boring job. And Act II presents us with the drudgery of his office, its repetitive work, its shallow relationships. Jean recommends that Berenger improve his cultural vocabulary, but Jean's appreciation of the avant-garde theater, for instance, is clearly only a surface interest, or he would not have succumbed so easily to the rhinoceros. Berenger's reliance upon alcohol is understandable. The ennui of daily life is too great not to escape. In fact, the escapism of alcohol is a trope for the escapism of the metamorphosis. Both Berenger and the others feel they regain their lost identities in their respective escapes. The others then are similarly oppressed by their jobs. Jean feels it is something one must get used to, though Berenger seems to be the only one who has a deeper awareness of the way bourgeois life crushes his spirit. Now there's this symbol that is used in the play of rhinoceros. The rhinoceros are a blunt symbol of man's inherent savage nature, but to Ionesco's credit, the articulation of this idea deploys slowly throughout the play. The first rhino causes no apparent damage, the second one tramples a cat. Later, one destroys more property and Jean as rhinoceros attacks Berenger. They represent both fascist tyranny and the absurdity of a universe that could produce such metamorphosis. These ideas crystallize into one question. How could humans be this savage, allowing the barbarity of World War II Nazism? Ionesco answers this in a variety of ways. He equates the epidemic of the metamorphosis with the ways the ideals of Nazism can infect the unconscious mind of individuals, yet the rhinos become more beautiful and human are getting ugly by the end of the play. They are beautiful, however, because of their brute strength and power. True beauty, as Berenger demonstrates when he finally decides to fight the rhinos and save humanity, lies in moral strength. If we talk about the characters, there are many of them. Berenger is the hero, he's the protagonist, an everyman slacker who finds neither his work in an office nor the culture around him fulfilling. Alienated yet still confused as to why he has been displaced, he is unwilling to commit himself to anything in life but his love for Daisy. His friend Jean constantly reprimands the submissive Berenger for his uncouth appearance and apathetic attitudes. Jean is Berenger's foil, a highly cultured, somewhat arrogant, angry young man who prides himself on his rationality. He urges Berenger to be more like him. The logician is a highly rational man who appears only in the first act but who is referred to several other times. Then we have the other characters, Daisy, who is Berenger's love interest. Then you have Botard, who is a senior member of Berenger's office, Dudard, who is a co-worker, Papillon, who is the head of Berenger's office, Mr. Bioff and his wife, Mrs. Bioff, Mr. Bioff, he appears offstage only as a rhinoceros. They have the townspeople, the old gentleman, grocer, grocer's wife, housewife, cafe proprietor, waitress, appear in the first act. They are characterized largely by their trivial concerns, though the old gentleman is very interested in the logician. Now, if you have any questions based on rhinoceros, please feel free to ask and I shall answer them. Thank you.